Rufus and Devin had just returned from the grocery store and had put their grandmother to bed. She's an invalid and cannot walk. They were walking toward Memphis Street. It is about 40 yards from their porch to Memphis Street. And that's a little less than 40 seconds. As they enter onto Memphis Street, the police car pulls around and they continue to walk down the street. There are no sidewalks, and so they're walking on the paved surface, but not in the middle of the street. There are no people, so there's no interaction with any person. The officer yells out of the car, "You morons, get off the street." The car then stops. The officer gets out, cuts around the back of the car, and walks toward them. They continue to walk, essentially ignoring the officer. The officer then walks onto the grass as they...
Did you hear me? Hi, how's it going? Take your hands out of your pockets. Do you have your IDs?
Yeah.
May I have them?
What's in my ID for? I was just walking by.
224, go ahead and send me an assist. IDs, fellas.
214.
ID. I will take the camera until you
give me your ID. Don't touch my camera, dog.
Huh? Give me your IDs. Give me your IDs. Give me your IDs.
Just give me IDs.
You don't remember me?
No, I don't remember you.
You sure? You don't remember me? The time when I had to come and help your sister get the kids from your brother?
No, I don't remember you.
You sure?
I'm fine.
You know what? Follow me to the car. Y'all want your IDs back. Follow me to the car. Follow me to the car.
Get these IDs back. What's
we gotta follow you to get IDs back? What we do?
No charges have been made.
What's going on?
No assertion of blocking traffic. No indication of anybody being intoxicated. The officer simply said, "Follow me to the car, and I'll give you an ID." At that point,
get down on the ground right now.
The word BS was used. The officer tackles.
What am I doing?
Congratulations, you're gonna do that now?
Congratulations. That's on my hands. For walking in the street.
Yep. Make sure you got that on camera too, girl.
I got it.
Good.
I ain't doing nothing.
What'd I do wrong?
224.
He asked for my ID. I gave him my ID.
And I seen, when we was coming out the house, he was standing over, he was parked over here. Then we walked in the street. That's when he pulled. And two.
My house is right there.
Yeah, like what?
I don't know where you live. All I know is you're out in the middle of the road.
But you just said you seen us walking from the house, right?
You cannot sit here and run your mouth and start cursing out in the middle of the street.
So now we're cut.
What?
We got another one. Another one.
Back.
This is essentially what happened. So, within 14 seconds after entering the street, the police car suddenly stopped and the officer jumped out and started to pursue them on foot. When they were questioned with their IDs in the officer's hand, no discussion was made of being blocking traffic. No discussion of didn't you see that you were blocking traffic. No discussion of cursing at any people. There weren't any people there. The only discussion was, didn't you hear me? And when they were compliant and walking on the sidewalk, the officer made a decision that he would pursue them. All the evidence points toward nothing other than two black men walking in the street and trying to not be upset by the tone of the officer's voice or his pursuing them. And when the question was asked, what is this BS? It was only then that the officer felt a need to arrest, to tackle Rufus, take him to the ground, handcuff him, and repeat what he said. Didn't you hear me?
I'd like to take just a minute or two to emphasize a few aspects about the narrative you've just seen concerning Rufus and Devin Scales that are important. It's important to have a context for anything, especially this. It's important to note that just roughly three hours prior to the officer being on the scene and immediately moving out towards the Scales brothers, is that Devin Scales received on his cell phone a screen image, a call coming in that said it was from the National Police with this number, 3 hours roughly before the incident that occurred at roughly 6:30. That's a very important piece. We do not yet know what this number means. When you call it, there's a recording that says, "We do not recognize your number, therefore you cannot access our system." We provided this number with details to Deputy Chief Henson of the Greensboro Police Department, who assured us that he would check into this. This was several weeks ago. We still do not know anything about how this happened to come up. And that number has called Devin's telephone several different times thereafter. What could this mean? Another important context is that in the spring of 2013, the police engaged and provoked an incident with Rufus and Devin, which resulted in Rufus being brutally beaten and injured. This is the spring of 2013, and it gives important context for why Devin had obtained a camera and was eager to take photographs of what was happening in the interchange that night recently, that late afternoon. It's important to also put into perspective that the officer's story now, that these gentlemen, one was drunk, they were cussing in the middle of the street, that's totally inconsistent with what factually happened, as you can see from the previous video. But for an officer who is training another officer, so this is a trained officer, to have encountered drunken, shouting men violating some traffic law, and then take their ID, not mention or make any sort of assertion about them being charged, not handcuffing them, but saying, "Follow me to my car and I'll give you your ID back," makes no sense. No officer would let such people walk behind them. What triggered this thing and what we see in a national context is this officer demanded to be in a dominant position and expected submission. And when Rufus Scales admittedly asked the officer as the officer was leading him in the car, "What is this BS?" And he said the word bullshit. "What is this BS about?" That triggered the officer to turn on and fling him to the ground. The rest of it is picked up in some video that you have seen, and the bringing of false charges against both of these men. This is a common practice. It happens throughout our land, and it gives some context. And I think Reverend Johnson can put it in an even broader context now of what's going on in our nation and why we must take a stand here in Greensboro to demand that these charges be dropped, that legislation be passed to authorize citizens' review inquiries about these matters, and to be sure that our next police chief supports independent citizen review commissions that can hold police accountable when they conduct wrongdoing. Reverend Jeff.
Just a quick comment on the incident that you saw earlier. It's about 24 yards from the steps of the Rufus and Devin's home where they were living, just put their grandmother to bed, to the street. They saw the police car parked on the corner. When they put their feet on the street, it was about 14 seconds before the police car pulled around the corner and engaged them. So all of what the police said, walking in the streets, blocking traffic, there absolutely was no traffic. We went out there for an hour yesterday, and not a single car passed by during that time. It's not that kind of street. There's no sidewalk to it. It's totally unreasonable, unjustified, and unnecessary. I just needed to add that. If this were a standalone case, that this happened, and it happened about 5 years ago to someone else, we could work with that in a different way. But when our prisons are bulging with young African Americans and Latinos, when our courts are gathering places on Monday where people are herded in and taken on buses to prisons, when people have to pay fines and accumulate these records, it's not isolated. And in 1969, when people were struggling for freedom, the police militarily attacked all of us, and a report was done. It called for some substantial changes. And I just want to walk you through this. In 1979, after police assisted in organizing a counter demonstration to terrorize and to that resulted in the death of five people, they mainly demonized those of us who were organizing around labor and around race. Again, a report was done. Nothing really came of it. Similar report in black and white. And let me point out that in 1985, Greensboro police officers, together with Klan and Nazis, were found liable for wrongful death. No apology. No reprimanding, no firing, not even a note put in the jacket of the officers found liable for wrongful death. They simply swept it aside and demonized. And in 2004 to 2006, a rigorous truth process took place, resulting in this document, 500 or more pages. First of all, the city council voted to oppose it, not just be neutral to it, but to actively resist it. And when the document came out, they refused to actually receive it and commend that it be studied. They did do something under Yvonne Johnson's administration, which was very, very little. I won't even go into it because it didn't change anything. And then when we documented the cases in this document, our democratic mission, the city manager and the police chief denounced it as flawed and without substance. I want to point out something in here that Lamont Armstrong did 17 years in prison in resulting from a frame-up and a flawed investigation by the Greensboro Police Department. It's documented right here. He got out recently, came by, we talked to him. No investigation of the flawed investigation ever occurred. And to my knowledge, Lamont hadn't gotten a nickel for being in jail for 17 years on false charges. Put forward a proposal for a process of how to change all of this on August the 26th. It may be a little hard to see this, but let me hold it up. We were meeting almost monthly with city officials, and it was just a lot of talk. And we said we're going to organize our own process because the people have a right to do that. They then argued that we shouldn't do that, give them time, trust them. On April the 29th, we put forward this proposal. All of this is on our website. It's a comprehensive plan for how we could build a democratic oversight mechanism. And I'm saying all of this is connected to what happened to Rufus and to Devin. Beloved, unless the citizens, or shall I say the residents, all of us who live here, come together and demand the changes, yet more than that, to organize ourselves to make sure stuff happens. That the government is willing to do and do properly, we're ready to work with it. But where the government is not willing to do and is going around making statements about trust us, we have to organize alternatives for our own well-being. That is kind of what we bring to the table. And so the challenge, I think, for every person in Greensboro who has one inkling of justice instinct is that we cannot allow our young people, old ones as well, to be ground up, oppressed, while we are engaging almost in a fantasy that this is just the way it is. There are now more African Americans in prison in the United States than there were slaves in 1850. What kind of situation is this? And it has become normal. That's why we call it, it is part of the culture. The whole culture has to be changed. And so we're glad you're here tonight, and we want to get a lot done. God bless you, and let's carry the work forward.